Privacy, compliance, and regulation. Watch out for GDPR, an opportunity, not a challenge. So we'll start speaking about GDPR beforehand. Me, if people do not know me yet, I'm Tal Ron. I'm from Tel Aviv. I live in Tel Aviv. I enjoy Tel Aviv. I believe many people already visited my city. You visited your city, this city? My friend?
Of course.
It's a test. What's your favorite place in Tel Aviv?
The restaurant, you mean?
The restaurant, the food.
Dizengoff Street.
Actually, you know that we have a verb, which is to dizengovize. If you want to go to Dizengoff Street, you call it in Israel, lizdangef, right? To dizengovize, to go to Dizengoff. It's like, you know, it's like in Gangnam style in South Korea. This is what our Gangnam is, Dizengoff Street. Yeah, so in Israel, we always look at us as part of Europe, even though we're not Europe. We like to export our services. We're a NIMBYistic country. NIMBY, not in my backyard. It means that you don't have B2B gambling in Israel, but we have a large exporting of B2B and B2C gambling services outside of Israel. So we can sit in Tel Aviv, in my backyard, and operate websites targeting nice people all about the world when it's illegal. So it's a nice thing to see out. But GDPR also touched us. And I'm a lawyer. I deal only with stuff that I'm interested in, like online gambling, gaming, mobile apps. That's what we do. And we have an office in Tel Aviv, and we have offices all around the world that deals together with me with our topics. So one of our issues is GDPR, and as I say, it's an opportunity, not only a challenge. Let's discuss it for a bit. In the wake of data breaches, GDPR is empowering users where their personal data is concerned. Of course, it's a good thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing, and we'll understand. It got into effect in May 25, 2018, okay? And this is actually applies to, let's say I have a company, let's say in Bangalore, and deals with data of subjects in the EU. GDPR applies. Okay? And there is a very specific list of data, what really we need to understand what is very sensitive. However, look at this. Failure to comply means that companies will face steep fines up to 20 million euro or 4%. And now people actually said, listen, that's a piece of cake. Because probably it's whichever is lower. But actually, it's with whichever is higher. So the threshold is actually 20 million and up. And they put these fines in order to catch all these multinationals that 20 million euro is not a big deal for them, or 44% is not a big deal. So you do have like a very nice fine, and we'll discuss some of the fines that are already been imposed. So, and if you have questions, feel free to ask, you know, because there's all this Slido thing, but you can also raise your hand the analog way, okay? The analog way to ask questions. So if you want, I see you there, you can ask questions. These are some of the GDPR highlights. Articles 13 and 14, the right to know how personal data is used. I want to know exactly, let's say I have my guys, you know, my users that are using my app, Stormhaven, okay? I want to go to, and you're compliant, okay? So, yeah, right, definitely compliant. So God can also testify that you're compliant. However, I want to know how personal data is used. So how this app are using my data. Let's say I want to play on Playtika's offerings and I want to play their newest social casino. I want to know exactly if my data is actually used only by you or whether it's been sold to Bet365 or Unibet or someone in the Scandinavia. Okay? I want to access my personal data. I want to rectify incorrect personal data. Let's say they're saying that I live in Hong Kong, but it's true. Okay? But maybe it's not true, okay? So I need to change that. Right to be forgotten. Right to be forgotten is part of my favorite bit, okay? Because here we actually say data erasure when data is no longer necessary and there is no legal obligation to keep it. But here's the tricky bit. Let's say I'm operating, a financial website, a Forex CFD website. Part of the, you know, national sport in Tel Aviv is to open a financial services website. That's cool, especially if it's regulated, okay? Now, look, let's say I have an issue with one of my clients, okay, I'm operating that website, and he says, okay, listen, we have an argument whether he did agree to trade on a $100,000 bid or trade, and then he lost all the money, okay? It's not always goes like that. Sometimes they win, sometimes they lose, but let's go on a situation where he traded on a really shitty bid, sorry, $100,000, he traded on the Bitcoin, and it all went down, okay? Now, he said, listen, I did not do that. I did not trade that bid, and then I have his IP, and I can prove that he did. So I need to keep this in order if the broker will have any problem with the client, I would like to leave this data intact. You agree with me? However, if we go to Article 17 of the GDPR, this client, this really good trader, can tell me, listen, please erase my data. So you see, I have a really, really big issue here. In one situation, I want to keep my data. The other situation, that really good trader want me to erase this data. So you understand, this conflict is something that hasn't been resolved yet. But you see some of the anomalies that we have in GDPR.
Good question.
Yeah.
Why would they want, like, what is a good example of the right to not, can you explain that, not forgotten?
Yes. Right? Of course. Yeah. Of course. There is a good, why would it be? Let's say I was in a dating site, okay? I was in a very hardcore dating site, okay? And I don't want, and then I got married, and I don't want my wife to know that I'm there. So that's a good example why I want to remove a person to Article 17. Or let's say I was playing in some of, you know, real gambling money and a website, and actually, you know, I don't want my spouse to know that actually I invested all my money in gambling. You know what I mean? So this is very, very important. The right to be forgotten is something very trivial. But the problem is that sometimes us, the merchants, the operators, the people who operate the websites want to keep that data for our monetary reasons, safety reasons, compliance reasons. So there is here a really big dilemma. Now, Article 27, we need to appoint an EU representative. You know, I actually bought a shampoo here in the shop of the Park Central, you know? And it says, I bought it was like, I don't know, it was a eucalyptus shampoo, and it says, I don't know, US, but there was also, sorry, it was made in the EU, but you have a US representative. So that's exactly the same idea, okay? If you do target EU clients, even if you stay in Oklahoma or in Wyoming, is there a place called Wyoming here? Yeah, it's also, it's sort of tax haven, Wyoming. You still need to appoint a EU representative. Now, part of what we do actually for my clients, we set up the EU representative. And I can tell you the trick. Many people think that it's much more, you know, like in the cosmetics, you use Belgium, you use, but in internet, you don't need to have a luxurious place to put an EU representative. You know, I'm not sure if you know that, but there are some very nice or not so nice, but you know, you don't need to be a tourist there. You know, you can be an EU representative if you open a company in Lithuania, in Estonia. You know, as long as it's the EU, that can be good. And actually, you know, it's much better to put an appoint an EU representative like in this kind of place than to pay someone in Berlin or in Frankfurt or God forbid in Switzerland. Okay? So Article 27 is very interesting. And also part of the issues that is very, very sensitive, and I'm not sure that everybody knows exactly what should be done here is 37 is the designation of the DPO, okay? The data protection officer. Data protection officer is someone that has probably sometimes it will be the one with the highest salary in the company now. Because now this guy or girl, will have the highest risk. Because this DPO is the guy or girl that can get all the lawsuits. And I can tell you, we are dealing with some lawyers from Malta who have now a national sport. You know, there are places in Malta, I like Malta, it's like a gambling island. And there are some lawyers that are sitting in Tashbiesh or in St. Gillian, some cities, and they do money from sending letters to app developers and gaming companies, please, you know, show me that you're compliant with GDPR. Very nice. And you send them a letter, and you know, they want 100,000 euro to cover their expenses in preparing the letter. And please pay us. And they give you 7 days to pay that money. Otherwise, we'll go to the EU Union. And you know, so it's interesting. So this is very interesting. And the DPO normally needs to settle with this kind of stuff. So that is the DPO. Now, GDPR applies both to controllers and processors. It's quite a fine line between the processor and the controller. Processor is the one who actually processes the data. The controller actually controls the data and which type of data. But you need to know that both of them actually applies to. And there was already enforcement against people from Canada. And people think that if you are outside of the EU, they won't touch you. That can be true if you without entering into political issues. I saw here people from Kiev and people from Kharkiv and other places in Ukraine. I think that it will be quite difficult to enforce GDPR against people from Ukraine. This is what I think and I suspect, okay? I could be proven wrong, but this is what I think. And I have good respect to the people there, but I think that it won't be very easy. But people from Canada, I think that it's quite easy and we saw it already. Now, what is personal data? And let's discuss that, and that's important because people do not understand how strange and how peculiar and how specific is personal data. So look, name obviously is a personal data, but did you know that also IP address is a personal data? So if you have a website or an app or a game that actually tracks your IP address, it's a problem. You know, this is GDPR. Now, phone number, payment information, website login, all of this geolocation, all of this is GDPR. That's very, very important. Yeah. Your name? Gino. Yeah. Gino.
What do you mean by ID numbers?
Okay, very good. What do I mean by ID number? ID number, we speak about, let's say, social security number. Let's say you're sitting in, in Estonia, you have an ID number, okay? In Israel, you have an ID number. Other places, you have a social security number, driving license number. Personal ID number is something which is GDPR. Okay, it's not, let's say, a fictitious ID that is given to you per session, but it's an ID number. So if you have a list which is actually sorted by ID numbers, it's GDPR, okay? No. No, it's not part of it. Good question. It's not part of it. It's not part of it, okay? Not part of it. Okay, let's speak about the impact of GDPR on your mobile gaming business. So we need to remain transparent and to process data lawfully, okay? And if you have questions, you can also ask me. You can send me. I can send you this presentation. I can send you, like, forms how to actually use and be compliant with GDPR. Okay, so you may no longer use opt-outs. This is one of the most important things. Users need to be opt-in. Now, you know, in Israel, there is something which we call kosher. You know, you want to explain? I will explain. Kosher is something when you eat, it's like, I don't know, it's religious acceptable. Now, there's regular kosher, and there's strictly kosher, like kosher lemahadrin, we call it in Hebrew, or in Yiddish, okay? So if you want to do opt-in is like kosher. If you want to be strictly kosher, you do double opt-in, which I think it's like to be holier than the Pope. You know, the Pope is holy, be even holier than the Pope, do double opt-in. No one asked for a double opt-in in GDPR. Sometimes, you know, want to be so, you know, safe, so they use a double opt-in. But that's you need to be aware that people are doing opt-in and sometimes double opt-in, and then you have some people, you know, and GDPR consultants that actually I saw forces their clients to do double opt-in, but then say, listen, the conversion goes down. No, but we have to do double opt-in. It's not true. You need to do opt-in, that's fine, okay? Change your website's cookie notices, we'll see it in a minute. Update your terms and conditions. Make sure use a consent form. I'll show you all of this. And of course, the DPO. Now look at this. How to change your cookie notice. You have here some kind of examples. You see, this website uses cookies. All tick boxes must be left as opt-in, okay? So we need to have it like with a box where you put the X inside and not untack. Now, I already saw clients of us in the UK not following our advice and received letters. It's important. It's important because it's not that big deal. You won't lose lots of clients if you'd be like this and give the client to be an active choice. So how to update your TNC? Use basic language so the average user can understand. It means that, you know, I cannot actually now start and write, you know, words that I like as a lawyer, pertaining, and, you know, like very sophisticated language and like very specific legal. No, you need to, like, you don't need to write it like a rap song. You know, you don't need to be very, very low. But you know, I all the time with rap songs, all you know, I'm trying to, you know, enlarge my vocabulary with words that I didn't know how to, you know. But here you need to do straightforward language. Make it easy to opt out. List data safeguards. Do you use cookies? Yes or no? Third parties? Which personal? All of this kind. We need to update the TNCs. Now I already saw people just stealing terms and conditions. You know, we are representing an app. A dating app, a very famous dating application, one of the top four by a public company. And I can tell you, you know, I actually saw that my terms and conditions that I authored for them was stolen by another application, dating app. So we actually filed a lawsuit in California on stealing the terms and conditions. So I'm just telling you, don't steal the terms and conditions. Make sure that someone, you know, not the brother, But let's say an internet lawyer will write for you the terms and conditions because it's important, and don't embarrass yourself with a lawsuit that can be publicized and that can, you know, if you market and you go to events and you want to go to shows in Vegas and you want to make sure that to everybody how original you can, you know, don't steal content, like you don't steal the slogan, don't steal the terms and conditions. Now look. The need to establish an EU representative, I explained that, but it's critical. Because people sometimes, you know, think, how can I find now an EU? So I said, no, it's not a big deal. You can open a company in Estonia. You know, you can put someone in Bulgaria. Actually, Bulgaria is cheaper than Estonia, but the English is not so well. So, you know, it's not, I don't want to enter into politics, etc. But Estonia is something, it's a place that I really, really recommend, even though in Sofia there are some, you know, some kind of good solutions also. So that's, you know, the idea of establishing an EU representative. He operates as a local, he coordinates all the issue in the EU, okay? And that's what we actually help our clients. We set it up for them, so they'll be like, you know, won't have that headache. Now, some other compliance tip: remain compliant, embrace regulatory changes. GDPR is only the beginning. Now, you understand that also in the EU, there's new stuff. And there's also in other places, and in Canada, those places, we'll speak about Russia, we'll speak about Asia, we'll speak about in a moment. But all of this trend is like, as I said, embracing the privacy. It's a really good word, you know, to embrace, to empower, you know, like very wow, wow, wow. But the thing is that this is not a joke, you know. Yesterday, I saw here, and it was super true, in several lectures, they were speaking about GDPR. Today also, I think Adam Rakiv also spoke about issues that regarding compliance. This compliance is something which is very, very important. We need to embrace it as an opportunity. Let's speak about other data protections. We spoke about GDPR. I saw GDPR starting in May 2018, game changer in the industry. Come join us, guys. We're speaking on compliance, privacy in mobile gaming, and of course, in development. So, as I said, GDPR is something which is cool or not cool, as you see it, but it's not the only thing that is relevant to us, okay? So, the other issues. So, let's speak about the Russian guys, okay? Again, normally in other ad-tech events, I saw lots of Russians and Ukraine guys. Here, many locals, some Asian, lots of Israelis. But many, many locals, okay? But Russian, I can tell you, normally they have a very, very strange data protection. And the thing is that actually pisses the Russian government and also the Chinese government the most is the idea that someone will deal with data of Russian data subjects outside of Russia. Well, that's the most critical issue. So if you solve it and you keep the Russian data inside Russia, most of the issues are already covered. It's interesting because you see the difference of mentality, and of course I'm saying it with full respect. So in Russia there is something which is called Roskomnadzor, okay, which is like the Russian communication agency. You need to make sure according to the law, and I'm sure that you know personally stories of lots of services that just do not work in Russia because they do not agree to keep that data in Russia. And this is why you find companies like VKontakte, which is like, you know, the Russian Facebook, and developed by an Israeli guy, again, originally, not Israeli, but Slava. He lives in Herzliya Pituach, a nice guy who developed VKontakte, sold it to his partners in half a billion dollars, and then, you know, moved on to other gaming companies and Plarium and other companies. So this guy, VKontakte, came and succeeded because of such data privacy rules. And we'll speak about, like, in China. You see what's going on in China, okay? In China, it's also very similar, and we all know about, you go to China, sometimes people, you know, if you go to Hong Kong, you can post, you know, from Facebook, but then you can go to certain places in China, and it doesn't work sometimes. Or sometimes it does work, and sometimes it does not work. So in China, it's very similar. You have, like, the place in China. Okay, this is why in China. You have WeChat, you have other places, and have other local services that actually replace this because they actually obey to these data privacy rules in China. So again, if you see, it's very, very similar to what's going on in Russia, okay? So Asia, I'm thinking about like Southeast Asia on one side, Russia on the other side, and it's very much important to understand that this trend will go, but even here, look, China and Russia, as you see, they're not as concerned very much on the right to be forgotten, but they're very concerned on one single thing, that the data will be kept in China and kept in Russia. I believe that you can understand why it's very important for them to be kept there, okay? There are lots of theories. Why is it, should it be kept there? But for us, we need to understand that that's the law. That's the law. You cannot sell goods to Russian clients without targeting them from servers inside Russia. Same goes with the Chinese guys. So it's important for us to be compliant also with this local, whether if we agree or whether if we not agree, we should do it. And that's fine, you know, and I can see that this mentality, if we want to work with certain jurisdiction, we need to understand and take it as granted. Now also, there's another issue, which is also relevant to compliance, is this new game changer, which is called MasterCard requirements for high-risk businesses. Now this, let's say you have a game which is identified as a high-risk game, or something that is catered toward adults, not very general. So we need to understand, we have new MasterCard requirements for marketing these games. Now, MasterCard wants you evidence that you're legally authorized to perform your activities, and you need to furnish a reasoned legal opinion that it's okay. And that's very interesting because that's a game changer. In November, it started with MasterCard, and then in December, I'm speaking about 2 months ago, it started also by Visa, okay? And you need, what's happening is that you can get fines that will be raised on you if you do not. And look how it looks like. These are some global legal opinions. You see, legal regime of marketing and promotion of foreign securities raised products according to Colombia, okay? And then you have in, that's Colombia, okay? That's the flag of Colombia, okay? That's the flag of Switzerland. Let's say you have an application that uses bitcoins or an application that actually sells foreign securities. All of this now, until November, until December, it was, let's say, a gray area. But now, if you want to use Visa and MasterCard, you need to bring legal opinions. And we had like 4 or 5 months just to chase lawyers all around the world to find lawyers that will be agreeing to write this, because this is, you know, very high responsibility. Because let's say you have an issue, then the people can come to the lawyers and say, I have a problem. So this is that's very interesting. So this is like from Colombia, this from Switzerland, Argentina, Chile. You know, ladies and gentlemen, this opinion is delivered to you in relation to an internet-based platform. I like it. It's like very, it's like a story, you know, like five or six, an internet-based platform. Hopefully they do not explain what is an internet and what is an application, but that's how it goes, because it goes, it's like, you see, it's actually addressed to MasterCard Europe SA, SA Societe Anonyme, like Limited or GmbH, like Germany. And so it's like, it's addressed to someone like for MasterCard. So it has to be like, you know, with all the story and explaining what is, et cetera. So that's regarding the legal opinions. Now, probably the last topic that I would like to deal in this session, and then I'll open it for questions, is actually the importance of our incorporation structure. And as we know, we're here in the United States. In the United States, probably the most popular places to incorporate is where? It's in which state? Delaware, exactly. Delaware, very, very popular. There are places there, the houses there with PO boxes and with registered addresses of many companies, like one after another, you know, shelf companies. So Delaware is very popular. Other two places which are very popular is Nevada. Okay, not only for gaming companies, but Nevada. And also Wyoming, you know, I don't know how this is how you say it, Wyoming? Yeah. Wyoming. Okay, Wyoming is also very popular. But that's in the States, okay? Outside of the States, there are other places, and let's discuss it and touch it briefly. Okay, Marshall Islands. Marshall Islands is funny because you send a letter to the Marshall Islands, it's like all the addresses ends in Marshall Islands, MH. MH is like, you know, like if you have New York, it's NY. MH is like Marshall Islands, so it's they look at themselves as part of the U.S. postal code, okay? They're part of the U.S. postal system, but they're not part of the U.S. It's somewhere in the, let's say, in the right-hand side of the world. You know, it's like, go, you know, you need to go to take my hand and go like, I don't know, it's like the end of the world there. But that's Marshall Island, and that's part of what's very nice in Marshall Islands, because it is in the end of the world. So you can open an offshore company there and you know, register it as the registered owner of the IP of your latest game. And then, you know, you can be like free of taxes. Let's say I want to be, you know, I wanna do a company and sell an IP for developing and for organizing conferences, okay? This is Elad Rozansky, is like very well known in the organization of conferences, right? So Elad, you can take the IP of your company.
Yeah, do you have a question?
Yes, I do.
Yeah,
great job.
Thank you.
Put you in the main floor, probably earlier. Just warm this all up. Good job.
Thank you.
I do have a question. All the documents and all the agreements that you see written around GDPR, it's all focused on cookies, obviously, right?
Not really. Cookies is an obstacle, but it's not the main one.
Let's speak offline,
and we'll be happy to help you. Okay, guys, thank you so much. Let's take the next speaker now.